On this week's Gadget Show Web TV, John's on the hunt for cheap fuel. I bring you the week's best tech news and manage to get time to stop and see Sony's latest range of Freeview HD TVs. Hello and welcome to this week's Web TV. Now, the world of apps has revolutionised the way we not only use our smartphones, but live our lives, from checking the latest cinema times to searching for your favourite restaurant. But most of this information is already available for free on the web. So John has decided to investigate this using the petrol prices app and website to see if it's really worth splashing your cash on the app when you can get the same information for free online.
Are there any iPhone apps that actually save you money? Well, one strong candidate, I thought, as I was browsing through the App Store the other day, was Petrol Prices Pro. It's an app version of the well-known website, petrolprices.com. The website which, once you've registered your details, will tell you the cheapest places to buy petrol near where you live, or indeed any other place you enter on the site. Now, that web version is free, and I find it actually does save me money quite regularly. The app version, however, costs £2.99. So, is it worth it, or would you be better off just accessing the website using Safari on an iPhone? Well, let's try it and find out whether there are any advantages in paying the £2.99. Open up the application. There's a pretty good interface. Gives you the choice of using your current location using the phone's GPS, or you can enter a place or postcode as well, which could be useful if you're heading somewhere. You get a lot of different choices to fuel type. There's a normal sort of unleaded and diesel. There's also options for super unleaded, LPG, even lead replacement petrol could be useful for owners of classic cars. You can tell it the distance to search within. There's a slider here that goes from 2 to 20 miles. I'm going to go with 2 miles because we're in town. So, we're using our own location, searching for unleaded near here. Let's hit search. And actually, it's pretty quick. Comes up almost immediately with prices in this area and a list of the cheapest stations. You can order it by distance. You can also order it by price. Now, Morrison's Small Heath. That seems to be the cheapest, 110.9p. I hit on that and I get a map with it on. I can even get directions on Google Maps. I think I'll go for that as well. Now let's try the web experience. Now I've got to enter the web address, obviously, and this time I can't use the location from the phone. I've actually got to enter a place or a postcode, and I can still choose the distance I wanted to search within. So I'm going to go for 2 miles and unleaded. And it's come up with the same list of places, which is pretty good, although this time I can't order them by distance, I'm just stuck with the price order. I get a map, but obviously I don't get any directions. Well, let's go and see if the petrol really is that price. And it's gone up! It's now 111.9. Obviously they don't update the information by the hour. So, is it worthwhile buying the app rather than just using the website on your phone? Well, I think yes. It's more convenient, you're much more likely to use it, and also you do get the benefit of unlimited searches over 3G. It certainly saved me money today.
News time now, and finally, after the initial event at the end of January, Apple have confirmed that the iPad will be arriving in UK stores at the end of April, with both the Wi-Fi and 3G versions shipping at the same time. But as ever, we're a step behind our stateside friends, as the iPad will be available for pre-order from the 12th of this month, and it'll be hitting their stores on the 3rd of April. It also looks like we won't be getting the iBooks app for the iPad just yet either, and with no mention of when it will arrive here in the UK. This is disappointing considering that being an e-reader is one of the device's major USPs. It just seems strange that we won't have access to legitimate books at the time of its launch. But nevertheless, we are still getting the device shortly after its release in America, and all we need to know now is how much it's going to cost. And no sooner after Apple announced the release date of their device, it seems Sony planned to release a number of new mobile devices and accompanying software to rival the iPad. The latest news is that Sony's new mobile strategy currently revolves around something called Sony Online Service, which will deliver content to a number of new smartphones and tablet-like devices. The Sony online service is expected to offer a range of music and video content similar to iTunes, but with an added bonus, a massive back catalogue of PlayStation games. This adds to rumours that Sony are currently working on a smartphone that can play the downloadable games designed for the PSP Go. A project is also underway to create a new device which will combine the best from the PSP Go and their e-reader range. Here's hoping that Sony can pull all of this off, as it's not going to be easy, especially when the iPad and other highly capable mobile devices are crowding the market. Last week saw the annual CeBIT trade show held in Germany. One of the announcements that caught my eye were the range of new EPCs, including the EPC 1015, the PC Prime 1018p and the Diary 1016p. The EPC Prime 1018p is one of the thinnest EPCs Asus has ever made, and at just 18mm thick, it packs a 10.1-inch LED backlit display, has USB 3 for fast data transfers and a fingerprint reader. We're currently waiting for more detailed specs on all three models, as well as pricing and a release date, but you can be sure as soon as we get wind of these, we'll let you know. Freeview HD fast becoming a reality, more and more products are being announced, such as Humax's T2 HD box and Freeview's HD Freeview Media Hub. Well, now it looks like Sony are joining in on the party with their latest range of Bravia TVs, which I was lucky enough to go and check out for myself. So I'm here with Christian from Sony, and he's going to tell us a little bit more about Sony Bravia's new television range.
This is the NX series, so this is aimed at consumers that are really after kind of design, but also networking functionality as well. So it has an integrated Wi-Fi chipset. Mm-hmm.
Brilliant. Now you say it's got Wi-Fi connections, so you know viewers would be able to access YouTube and watch clips on the big screen?
Absolutely, yeah. YouTube will be part of Bravia Internet Video, which is a new service we're launching in the UK. So we're launching with people like Love Film and Demand 5, but you'll be able to get YouTube, Facebook, Flickr on there as well. All very, very easy, access via the cross-media bar, so it's very, very simple.
Now, I know that Freeview HD isn't currently available everywhere, so for those of us who don't have Freeview HD being turned on in their area, is it still a great purchase? Will it upscale standard definition signals?
Yeah, absolutely. So using the Bravia Engine 3, it will upscale for those consumers that aren't getting access to Freeview HD for the next couple of years. But again, it comes with the latest Freeview HD tuner for those consumers that are in that those areas.
Are they 3D ready or compatible?
So these ones won't be. Okay. The LX series and NX 900, they will be, so 3D ready or 3D with glasses in the box, coming a little bit later in the year.
Now, we at the Gadget Show are very excited about OLED technology ever since we had the XL1 in our studio last year. But I read recently that this model had currently been taken off the shelves in Japan. I was just wondering if OLED still features in Sony's long-term plans.
I'm sure given the level of investment we've put into it, it will form one part or another. You just have to look at CES where we had the 3D OLED screen. But it's about having it at price points and features that consumers will kind of buy into, if you like. So I'm sure that there will be something in the future, but right now it's kind of focusing on the technologies that are coming through, and hopefully in a couple of years we might see something, but fingers crossed.
So when is this available, and what price range are we looking at for this particular model?
From the end of this month, so from the end of March, price is in the region of about £1,400.
Right, I'm here with Ed. He's the Proposition Development Manager for Sony. Do you want to show us through the features?
So what we're talking about here today is Bravia Internet Video. So for us, it's really connecting the device straight to the internet.
Brilliant.
Allowing consumers to access content directly on their Blu-ray player, Blu-ray home theatre kit, or Bravia TV. So one of the key services we're talking about today is Love Film. So Love Film arranged a selection of movies on here where you can literally highlight a movie you want to watch, press play, and it starts streaming it straight away straight to your device as well. One of the features we're talking about here today is Channel 5 as well. So we announced Channel 5 back at IFA last year.
Yeah.
And so Channel 5 are going to be delivering 5 on demand straight to your TV. So here, obviously, you know, it's great soap operas, great kind of American TV and shows like that.
Does it do series links as well? For example, if heaven forbid, you missed the Gadget Show and it's on demand 5, you could sit and watch one and it would carry on to the next one? Does it series
Absolutely.
Link and stuff?
So, I mean, because it's streaming and it's video on demand, you can just choose the episode you want to watch. You
Brilliant.
Don't have to kind of pre-arrange on your EPG. But again, the great feature about this, well, two great features to me are the fact that Bravia Internet Video actually scales the video really quite nicely. So you see the original size of the content
Of course.
So it's actually quite a low resolution. Mm. But Bravia Engine 3 really kind of makes it look pretty fantastic when you'd be sitting 8 feet back on the TV and looking on the screen there.
Right, well, there you have it. We've heard about Sony's new range, and I can't wait to get one of these in my living room.
Well, that's all we've got time for this week, but remember to sign up to our Facebook and Twitter pages and catch the main show this Monday night at 8 on 5. This week, Jason and Otis design and build a brutal tech-filled fighting robot to create some of their very own Robo-Armageddon. John finds his way to the Caribbean to test some of the latest Bridge SLR cameras, and Susie gets to grips with a human-powered sub called the C-Bomb. But from us here at Web TV, we'll see you at the same time, same place next week.